not to be left all holding on. You like to bake it, and I like to chop. You like to make it, and I like to mop. Potatoes, potatoes, tomatoes, tomatoes, left all holding on. But all this is the holding off an evil heart. And all with your heart, and that might break my heart. So you like to jam, and I like to jump. I wear a pajama and give up the job. For the snowy, need a snowy, let's go going on, on, let's go holding on.
Yes, I want to speak with Mr. Howard Neiman. Okay, I'll hold.
Oh, Bob!
Hi, honey.
I'm in the reviews. How are you feeling?
Well, I'm not exactly dancing with glee.
Well, it isn't fair.
Shh! This is Neiman. I'm waiting for him to get off the other line.
But it isn't fair. You published books of quality and distinction, and you should be the one to get the credit.
You're 100% correct, and you're beautiful besides. Oh, hello, Howard. How are you? Sure, I read the notices, Howard. Yeah, well, we were both hoping for a better break, but on the other hand, there are some very good quotes here. Magician with words and so forth. And with a book like yours, there's bound to be more in the weeklies. I'm confident we'll go into another printing. What do you think of the notices? Sure, we all wish Orville Prescott would write a novel. Now, Howard! Calm down, Howard! Look, I hope you're not going around talking like this. Well, for one thing, people don't read reviews that carefully. All you do is spread the bad word. Look, let me give you some advice from Jake Cooper in publicity. In his course, What Memorable Words, nobody knows you have a boil on your behind if you don't tell them.
Oh, what did he say?
He said the boil's not on his behind. It's on page 34 of the New York Times.
Well, why shouldn't he be mad? It's a wonderful book.
Now that's what I like, loyalty. Hey, I got you something and I forgot.
Oh, for me?
Yeah. It's Valentine's Day, did you forget? To the sleep. Will you be my Valentine?
Sure, I'll be your Valentine.
Uh-oh. Door is open. Shall I come in?
Certainly, Oscar. Come on. Tiffany, I want you to meet Mr. Oscar Nelson, my old friend and my new tax lawyer.
Hello.
How do you do?
And this lovely long creature is Tiffany Richards. We're getting married next month.
And she'll be deductible. Congratulations.
Well, I'm very happy he has you as tax lawyer, Mr. Nelson. Don't you think it's just outrageous? The government investigating his back taxes just like he was Frank Sinatra.
Under the law, we're all equals.
Oscar, imagine this clunk from the FBI barging in here and accusing me of fleecing the government of $6,000.
Wait. In the first place, this clunk is not from the FBI. He's from the Internal Revenue Service, a small but real distinction. In the second place, he's not accusing you of anything. He's merely asking you to provide proof that this $6,000 was a legitimate professional expense.
Well, I'm not coughing over $6,000, I can tell you that. I'll move to Alaska.
You're too late, it's coming to the union.
Darling, there's nothing to be upset about. Mr. Nelson will handle this man. Now I'm going to bring you your mid-afternoon cocktail. Mr. Nelson, would you like one?
Oh, not this early, thank you.
Oh, it's not alcohol. It's raw milk, brewer's yeast, and wheat germ.
Not this early, thank you.
It sounds awful, doesn't it? But it's incredible the energy it gives you.
I'll have to try it sometime.
You have no intention of trying it. And you know what? You should, because you're definitely undernourished. Look at your ears.
What about them? I know they stick out.
Oh, they're whitish. Here, let me see your fingernails. See how pale they are? A really healthy person will have pink ears and pink fingernails. And another thing, a healthy person will have a tongue the color of beefsteak.
No, I'll spare you that.
I'm going to bring you your cocktail and you try it.
You think that's a lot of damn nonsense, don't you?
How did you know?
Because that's what I thought. But I've seen the results and I am completely convinced. And if you want to know, I love being clucked over.
I'm delighted to hear it. And your ears were never lovelier. Now, shall we get down to business?
Oh, yes, let's. I'm in a real mess here, Oscar. Actually, it's been a muddle ever since I started paying alimony. Now this taxes, what am I gonna do? I suppose you read those notices. I'm not gonna make anything of an even book. Somewhere something has gotta give, and I have to have the whole thing straightened out before I get married.
We'll see what we can do.
You know what I want? A bird's eye view of my entire financial picture. What I'm spending, what I should be spending, where I should be cutting corners.
All right, I've already come to a few conclusions, but I will want to look in your file.
Thanks, Oscar. And I appreciate you coming over here on a Saturday. Actually, I appreciate you taking on the whole dumb job. I didn't think you would.
Why not?
Well, you wouldn't handle the divorce.
Mary was as much my friend as you were.
Besides, I never thought you'd go through with it.
I thought of you as the golden couple smiling over steaming bowls of Campbell's chicken soup.
Oh, brother.
What happened?
What happens to any marriage? You're in love, then you're not in love. You know, I married Mary because she was so direct, straightforward, and said just exactly what she meant.
Why did you divorce her?
Because she was so direct, straightforward, and said just exactly what she meant.
When did you see Mary last?
Oh, I guess 8 or 9 months ago.
Well, you're going to see her this afternoon.
Yeah, like hell I am.
Bob, I called Mary in Philadelphia and asked her as a special favor to come up here.
But why in God's name would you, why the hell would you do that?
Because you have $5,000 worth of canceled checks which you can neither identify nor explain. Some of them Mary signed. I'm hoping her memory will be a little better than yours.
But I have an appointment here in 10 minutes with Dirk Winston. You remember him?
The movie actor, sure.
Yeah, well, we were in the Navy together. Now he's living in this building.
Well, it's nice that you two old sailors can get together. There ought to be many a salty story, many a hearty laugh.
Oh, no. You don't get it. He's written a book.
What?
Yes. His life story in 318 ungrammatical pages.
Life among the oranges. Oh, not a bad time.
Sure, I guess so. But I can't imagine it on our lists.
I gather you're not going to do it.
Of course I'm not going to do it, but I get talking to him about it. There's no easy way to tell an author you don't want to do his book.
Well, it's not going to be sweet. Make it short. I can take Mary into the office.
Oh, Mary. And don't you leave me here alone with her for 1 minute. You understand me?
Oh, she's only 5'3".
Never mind that. When am I going to get to these galleries? I have to have them back to the printer by Monday.
What are you eating?
Dried apricots. Full of vitamin C.
The things I'm learning today. Now, what's that like?
Oh, fascinating. I want you to read it. It's, told in the first person, and when we start off, we're coming back from a funeral, but only gradually do you realize that the narrator of the story is the dead man.
Sounds sensitive, very sensitive.
Oscar, I can think of only one way to make a killing in this business. A new series. You could take all the great sex novels, Lady Chatterley's Lover, Peyton Place, and have them rewritten for the 10 to 12 age group.
It took me longer because the wearing blender was broken.
Thanks, honey.
And I had to use an egg beater. Oh, but you've got to taste it anyway.
Honey, I want you to put on your new gray bonnet and get out of here.
But Bob, aren't we going to Goshen? Dad's expecting us.
Certainly, I'll pick you up at 5:30. No, you better make that 6.
But why do I have to go?
Because in my winning boyish way, I'm asking you to.
Oh, I know why. Because that sexy movie actor is coming over. You think in 10 minutes I'll be sitting on his lap, giving him little growls of rapture.
Don't be ridiculous. What do you need vulgar good looks when you have me around? No. The truth is, my ex-wife is descending upon me this afternoon.
It was my idea. I thought she might be able to shed some light on this tax matter.
Oh, well, I'm delighted. I've been dying to meet her.
Well, you're not going to meet her.
Yes, I am.
Tiffany, honey, you're a sweet, reasonable girl, and I insist that you stay in character. Besides, when am I going to get through those galleys? Now stop all this nonsense and kiss me.
I won't. I am not going to turn into Joan Fontaine.
What the hell are you talking about?
Don't you remember Joan Fontaine in Rebecca? Hmm? She was always thinking of the first Mrs. De Winter. At night, she used to imagine she could see her ghost on the staircase with her long, black Indian hair floating out behind her. Don't you remember? She shuddered every time she saw the monogram on the silver brushes.
Silver brushes? Mary used to use plastic combs with tails on them. She would crack off the tails so they would fit in her purse. Her hair was tied back in a bun. Tiffany, this is so silly.
I'll tell you another reason why I ought to meet Mary. Mm-hmm. We probably have a lot in common. Daddy says that a man goes on making the same mistake in judgment.
That's supposed to be an epigram because I don't get it.
Well, practically everybody Daddy knows is divorced. It's not that they're worse than other people, it's just that they're richer. And you do begin to see a pattern. Well, you know Howard Pepper?
Uh-huh.
Well, when he divorced his first wife, everybody said, oh, what he endured with Maggie, it was hell on earth. Then when he married the new girl, everybody said, she's so good for him. But when he met her, she looked like Maggie, she talked like Maggie, it was Maggie all over again. And his third wife was exactly the same thing.
Hey! I get the whole ghastly picture. But I promise you on my sacred oath as a Yale man that you do not resemble my ex-wife in any way, shape, or form.
Well, is that good?
Good. That's benediction from heaven. You, sweet idiot child, soothe my feathers. Mary, always, always ruffled them. Life with Mary was like being in a phone booth with an open umbrella. No matter which way you turn, you got it in the eye.
Well, at last, a plain statement. And now that you've opened up a little, tell me, where did you meet her? Who introduced you?
No, I don't think we were introduced.
You picked her up?
Well, sort of. Do you know that book we published, Our Kingdom Come? It was sort of an allegory. The pilot of the plane turned out to be God.
I don't think so.
Well, they turned it into a plane. Of course, it had to go to the opening night, and it was awful. It was really grisly. And we were all standing outside on the sidewalk after the second act, too stunned to talk. Actually, it didn't seem like there was anything you could say. Finally, this one girl spoke. She was standing off to the side in a polo coat, smoking a cigarette. And she said, well, it's not uneven. You don't get that, do you? Anyway, I laughed and we started to talk. And,
you said we don't have to go back in there. Let's have a drink.
You see, you already know. I don't have to tell you.
Well, did you kiss her that night?
Come on, put your coat on. You're just stalling for time.
I'll bet you did.
Did what?
Kissed her that night.
I didn't kiss her for weeks.
I don't believe it. You kissed me on the second night in the elevator, do you remember?
Oh, I made certain fumbling attempts, but she'd always make some little joke like, let's not start something we can't finish in a cab on 44th Street.
Well, where was she when you finally did kiss her? On an operating table under ether?
No, actually, we were in a cab on 44th Street. No, really. She smashed her hand in the door somehow, and she was pretending like it was nothing, and we're chatting along, and then all of a sudden, this was blocks later, she started to cry. I looked at her hand, and two of the nails were really, really smashed. It started off, I was just trying to comfort her.
Oh, this is the most unromantic story I've ever heard.
Well, they certainly won't get a movie out of it. I told you it wasn't worth going into.
Well, did she cry a lot in taxi cabs?
No, actually, she never cried again. Ever, any place.
These figures for 1960, can that represent the total profit?
I'm afraid so. Oh, Oscar, would you get that for me?
Oh, 2 minutes and I promise I'll go.
All right, I'll take you out the back and get you a cab.
Oh, I feel like I'm caught in rain.
I'm not adult, and no coward would wash his hands of me.
Hello, come in.
I'm an old friend.
I know you're Dirk Winston. Bob will be right back. My name is Oscar Nelson.
Oh, Bob, please!
And her name is Tiffany Richard.
It kind of makes me homesick for the backlot of Paramount. You know, I thought I was late, but suppose I take this downstairs. I'll be back in 10 minutes.
I think recess should be over by that time.
Wait until you see this. I saw this in an antique shop. You see, it's supposed to be Geronimo, but it looks so much like Jack Warner, I couldn't resist.
Oh.
dear Alfred. Lovely to see you. Where's...
Oh, he'll be right back. He just... Wait a minute. What's happened to you? You look absolutely marvelous.
Did you say that right?
Fair enough, because I'm not getting an answer.
Well, you see, I had been using an ordinary shampoo, which left a dull, unattractive film on my hair.
Oh, I'm interested. The hair is different, the clothes, the makeup. Clearly, loving hands have been at work.
Yes, but you're not supposed to notice. I mean, you're supposed to have an appreciative gleam in your eye, but you don't have to remind me of the dreary hours at Elizabeth Arden's.
Appreciative gleam? I've been casting your lustful glances. You're just too pure to notice. What caused the transformation?
Well, being divorced is like being hit by a Mack truck. If you live through it, you start looking very carefully to the left and to the right. And while I was looking, I noticed I was the only girl wearing a polo coat and no lipstick.
Well, I never noticed. Well, let me see if I can locate...
Oh, no, wait. Please, let me have a cigarette first.
You nervous?
Well, certainly not. But I haven't seen Bob in 9 months. I think I can wait another 5 minutes. Besides, you and I have a lot to talk about. How's Jennifer?
Well, she had this illegitimate baby after she met that man from the A&T. But it's all right now.
Oh, good. How's everything at the office?
You haven't heard one word I've said.
You're right. I'm not listening, and I shouldn't have come. I'm nervous.
Mary, do you still...
No, I don't steal anything.
I'm sorry. I should have realized.
Stop it. Don't give me that sad spaniel expression as though you just looked at the x-rays. I'm all right, doctor. Just fine.
Well, you did get here, I see.
Of course, she knew the address.
Hey, Oscar,
be right back.
Hello?
You look very different. You've changed. I was gonna ask you how you've been, but I can see you've been fine.
How about you? Did you ever clear up that case of athlete's foot?
No, you haven't changed.
Well, you know what they say, the more we change, the more we stay the same. Good Lord, these are dried apricots.
What'd you think they were?
Ears.
Well, I want to say that I appreciate you coming here today. I'm sure you didn't want to.
Oh, nonsense. It put my mind at ease. You can't think how often I've worried about the philodendron.
I'm sure. Now, Oscar has explained to you that our 6061 tax returns are being...
I advise you to make a clean breast of it. Admit everything.
This does not happen to be a subject for comedy. I have to get this whole thing straightened out. I'm getting married in 2 weeks.
Oh?
I'm sorry, I thought you knew. Surely Oscar must have told you.
But of course, and it went right out of my head. But how nice. Do I know her?
No, you don't.
Do you?
Her name is Tiffany Richards. She's
Tiffany? I'll bet she uses brown ink, and when she writes, she draws little circles over the eyes.
She happens to be a beautiful, lovely girl with a head on her shoulders.
How useful!
You know, you have a real talent. I've been here for 5 minutes and already I'm...
Have a dried apricot.
Oscar! Did you fall asleep in there?
Not me.
Can we get this thing over with? I'm sure you have to go back to Philadelphia.
Oh, I'm staying in town tonight, so you may consider that my time is your time.
Okay, Mary, I want you to look through these checks. Most of them you signed.
Oh, dear, I'm not going to remember any of these.
Oh, just give it time. You understand, we're particularly looking for items that might be deducted. Business entertainment, professional gifts, so...
Okay. L. Bernstein, $78. Oh, that's impossible. The only L. Bernstein I know is Leonard Bernstein, and I don't know Leonard Bernstein.
It's how Bernstein is a dentist.
I told you, Sidney Bauer is my dentist.
And it's that man in Boston.
What man in Boston?
Do you remember that crazy restaurant? You go down all the stairs and you thought you got a stone in your curry, but it was your inlay? You drove all the way to Framingham because he was the only dentist who would take us on a Sunday.
Yeah.
By the way, how was that inlay?
Just great. How are your crowns?
And we have Mrs. Robert Connors, $300.
Mrs. Connors?
So long as you walk this earth, you remember Mrs. Connors. Bootsy Connors and her fish.
Oh my God, that ghastly weekend in Greenwich.
Come on, tell Daddy.
You remember that young English critic, Irving Mannix?
The angry young man.
Well, this was 2 years ago. He was just a cross young man then. Anyway, at the time he was working on long scholarly articles trying to prove Shakespeare was a homosexual.
That's sort of the intellectual's answer to photoplay.
Anyway, he was staying here when we were invited to a party at the Connors. Yeah,
so we brought along dear old Irving.
Do you know the Connors place in Greenwich?
No.
Oh, well, the dining room is about the size of the ballroom at the St. Regis. We feel it would be just the place to sign a treaty. Anyway, it was all too rich for young Mannix, and he was lapping up martinis. In 15 minutes, he was asking our hostess if it was true that the Venetian paneling wasn't really brought over from Third Avenue.
Why didn't you take this charmer home?
Because he passed out in the library.
On that damn velvet sofa.
But he woke up long enough to light up a cigarette. Now, presently, the sofa was on fire. I'm not telling you, Oscar was really on fire, but our young hero had the stunning presence of mind to leap up and put the fire out with a tag of tropical fish.
And these were no run-of-the-bowl goldfish. These were from Haiti. I mean, they were friends of the family. They had names.
Well, he was a writer. I guess we can call that professional entertainment. Okay, we have $25 to the Beach Haven Inn.
That must be yours.
Don't be ridiculous. I've never been to the beach yet. Ah, the Booksellers Convention. The awful hotel with the iron deer in the front.
And the night clerk who looked like Norman Vincent Peale and was so suspicious.
No wonder he was suspicious. He turns around to get the key, and this one says just loud enough for him to hear, "Darling, do you think we're doing the right thing? Maybe we should wait."
He was delighted to come face to face with sin.
That's probably why he charges $4 to bring up 3 beers to the room.
Yeah, but he forgot the bottle opener, so we had to pry them open on the handle of the radiator.
Yeah, and one of them was warm or something, because it splashed all over the ceiling and soaked one of the beds. We both had to sleep in the other twin bed.
Oscar, we're being inefficient. We don't need total recall, just the facts. I'll take these into the office and make notes on the ones I can remember.
Mary looks wonderful, don't you think?
Oh, that's great.
Like $1 million bucks.
I'm afraid the figure that comes to mind is $5,000 in alimony.
Your friend from California.
Hey, Dirk, how are you? Good to see you. Say, how long has it been?
I don't know, we were still in sailor suits.
Say, Dirk, you know my
we've met.
Hey, you know, Dirk's the expert we should consult. You've been married 4 or 5 times. How the hell did you manage it?
I feel like a failure to admit I was only married 3 times. Actually, I married my first wife twice. So while there were 3 marriages, there were just 2 wives involved.
Oh, well, what do you do, pay them both alimony?
No, my second wife just married a very nice plastic surgeon. He fell in love with her while removing a wart from her shoulder blade. You know, I always thought there was a popular song in that.
What about the first wife?
She died.
You see, them that has gets.
Well, I know you two have business to talk about, so I'll get back to my arithmetic.
Yes, down to business.
So, Dirk, you look great, younger than ever. How the hell do you manage it?
I tell you this, it gets harder and harder. If I don't get a full 10 hours sleep, they can't do a close-up. If I eat a ham sandwich after 4 o'clock, it shows up on the scale. Ham sandwich, hell, I can gain weight from 2 bare aspirins.
You sound like the curator of your own museum. Come on now, it's been worth it, hasn't it?
Sure, but you develop such nutty habits. Do you know what all middle-aged actors do when they're alone in taxicabs?
What do they do? What do they do that for?
It firms up the jawline, old boy. I tell you what I dream of doing. My dearest ambition in life is to let my damn jawline go. Well, that's why I wrote this book.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. Have you read it?
Oh, yeah, certainly I've read it.
Yeah.
The question is, Dirk, shall I be perfectly frank? Oh, my, you bruise easily, I see. Did you show this to anyone else?
My agent, who thought it was brave, haunting, and hilarious. I put it to you first because I knew you.
I'm sorry, Dirk, but the truth is, it's not a book at all. For the moment, let's rule out the quality of the writing.
Let's not rule out anything. What about the quality of the writing?
Well, it's,
Is lousy the word you're groping for?
Let's just say it's not prose. Actually, it's not even punctuated. It's like you waited till you ran out of breath and threw in a semicolon. However, that can be fixed. What can't be fixed is the content. It's really nothing more than a collection of anecdotes. It's like you picked up where Luella Parsons left off.
I gather then that you do not wish to publish this book. Do you think somebody else would take it?
There are a few fringe outfits.
I don't want a fringe outfit. Tell me this, how much does it cost to publish a book? Any book?
Depends on the size of the printing, the length of the
book. All right, let's get down to cases. How much would it cost to bring out my book with the first printing of, say, 12,000 copies?
I'd say $8,000 or $9,000.
Let's say I made a check out to you for $18,000. Would you do the book?
You know, if you proposition women with this same kind of finesse, you must get your face slapped a lot.
I thought it was worth a try, but don't get mad.
No, I'm not mad. But I am a surprise. I mean, why does this book mean so much to you? It can't be the money.
Well, it may sound naive to say this, but being a star has never killed my urge to become an actor. You know, about 10 years ago, I started to campaign for real parts, but the formula was still making money, so I kept right on. Passionate kisses, and then I'd build the Suez Canal. Passionate kisses, and then I'd open the Golden West.
What do you figure? You're all washed up in Hollywood?
Technically, no. I still have two more pictures to go on my present contract. But when I left, they knew, and I knew, that I was just a sinking ship leaving the rats.
Well, why this sudden leap into literature?
Well, my press agent thought that... Oh, what the hell? Why blame him? I thought it might stir up a little interest in me as a man instead of as a wind-up toy. You see, in my fantasies, I imagined it would be serialized in the Saturday Evening Post, with pictures of me looking very seedy. And then all of a sudden, producers would be saying, yeah, don't laugh. You know what would be perfect for the role of the degenerate father? Dirk Winston!
Oscar would like... Excuse me.
Hello there.
Dirk, this is, my former wife, Mary McCalloway.
Dirk Winston! Your real name is Winston Cribb. Dirk is Cribb spelled backwards.
Good Lord, how did you remember that?
Oh, I have a head full of the most useless information. I still remember the names of each of the Dion quintuplets and the width of the Amazon River.
Oh.
You have no idea how few people care about the width of the Amazon River. I understand you've written a book.
Yeah, well, that's what I understood until I talked to Bob here.
Bob was a special case. He was frightened at an early age by a bestseller.
Oh, he was?
I wasn't. Why do you say that? It's simply not true. Just that I just think that there's great wisdom in Emerson's remark that you should never read a book until it's at least a year old. And I like to think that I'm publishing the kind of books that'll be around in a year.
I'm fed up with the novels about tangled lives in Scarsdale, or old Salem for that matter. All he knew was that he was a man. And she was a woman. Or had he been dreadfully mistaken?
Bob, are you coming?
Oh, Dirk, I'll be right back.
Hey, don't think about me. We're all through. I wouldn't want you to be any clearer.
Bob, I might as well go too.
Right now?
Well, don't you have a date?
Well, yes, I am meeting Tiffany in a minute, but could you hang around for a couple of minutes? There's something I want to ask you.
I used to love your movies. Of course, I didn't see all of them. My mother wouldn't let me.
That's all right. I didn't see all of them either. My agent wouldn't let me. Are you a writer?
Oh, no. I work for the Ladies' Home Journal. I edit the letters to the editor.
You mean they have to be edited?
It does seem a little like incest, doesn't it?
Bob did say that you were his former wife, didn't he?
That's right.
I'm so glad.
Why?
Because I can ask you to dinner. Will you have dinner with me?
Tonight?
You have a date?
No.
Well, then what's wrong with tonight?
I guess I just think we should have known each other longer, like, say, another 5 minutes.
You think you're letting yourself in for an orgy? You think I'm going to ply you with liquor, lure you up to my sinful bachelor lodgings, and then chase you around a king-sized bed?
Well, I've never been plied with liquor.
Come on, we'll have dinner. Duck Soup is playing at the Museum of Modern Art. I promise you, I will be so respectable, you'll find me quite tiresome.
Well, I have a new dress that'll look pretty silly all by itself in shrouds. Why not? I'd love to. Did you want to pick me up here?
Mm-hmm.
What time?
Half an hour.
Okay.
By the way, you don't live here, do you?
Oh, no. We're not as civilized as all that. This is business.
Oh, fine.
Yeah.
Now, I'll see you, Bob. I've got to call into the coast. Half an hour?
Okay.
Mary, thanks for having me around.
Standing alone in the middle of the field, he was grateful once again to be in possession of his own body. The Queen Anne's legs waved in the breeze like a thousand tiny handkerchiefs. This sounds suspiciously like our friend O'Brinner, and no wonder. I thought you weren't going to do this one.
Why not?
Because this man writes like a sick elf.
I skip that for now. Mary.
Bob.
I've been thinking.
I thought you had an odd expression.
Would it be absolutely impossible for you to listen to me for 5 minutes straight without making one single wisecrack?
Well, I could try.
Well, I wish you would. I really wish you would, because I have to ask you something, and I can't do it through a barrage of flippantries.
Oh, you'd be surprised. I don't feel flippant at all. What is it you want to ask me?
You know that I'm getting married again.
Yes, I know that.
Well, I find myself stewing over a very curious thing Tiffany said today.
Oh?
Her idea is that people go on making the same mistakes over and over again. I've had an eerie feeling that there's something true about that. Look, what I'm trying to say is that I have, by God, got to make a better go of it this time. Yes?
I didn't say anything.
But you were thinking.
Look, you say your lines, and I'll say my lines. You're hoping for better luck this time, and I hope you'll have better luck this time. But beyond that, I don't see what this...
You can tell me what I did wrong. After we broke up, I spent many a drunken hour half thinking how it was all your fault. Oh, I know, I'm painting a charming picture of myself, Bob McKelloway, a slob and sorehead, but that's how I felt.
And that's how you still feel?
No. After I calmed down and cleared the last of your bobby pins out of the bathroom, I realized that at least half of it had to be my fault.
You think it can be divided into two equal parts, like a sandwich?
I think there are no rules for success, but you can learn a great deal from failure.
Oh, I see. And what you're really looking for is a formula for instant marriage.
I'm not as sappy as all that. I'm prepared to make a number of new mistakes. I would not like to make the same ones. And I would like some advice.
Had you thought of writing to Dear Abby? Bob, I know that's the kind of thing I promised not to say, but what you're asking is impossible. I can't give you a report card. Is he punctual? Does he complete the task assigned? Do you know, this is so like you. This determination to be sensible in a situation where it isn't sensible to be sensible. You want to analyze and analyze, like those people who take an overdose of sleeping pills and then sit there making notes while they're dying. You know, 4 a.m. Vision beginning to blur. You would do that, you would.
Maybe.
But what shall I say? I mean, that you used to leave your ties on the coffee table? And that you never talked to me in cars.
Of course I talked in cars.
Yes, to the traffic signal. Come on, damn it, turn green.
I like to concentrate when I drive.
You're always asking solemn, editorial type questions, beginning, don't you ever, like, don't you ever order lunch meat? Don't you ever put the lid back on the mayonnaise jar? Don't you ever put your cigarettes out?
That's because you never in your life put a cigarette out.
And you always put the ice cube trays back without filling them.
Ice cube trays? Is that all you remember?
Aren't you forgetting one small detail? You're the one who walked out.
Technically, I suppose that's true.
Technically? There was nothing technical about it. You got up in the middle of the night and slammed out of here. And you know what? I never knew why.
Like hell you didn't!
No, all I knew was one minute you were in bed and the next minute you were banging drawers and dumping shirts into a suitcase.
Oh, that's all you remember?
Yeah.
Let me recreate the scene for you. I was in the bathroom brushing my teeth. You were in bed reading McCall's. I came into the bedroom, turned off the lights, got in bed with you, put my arms around you, and you said, okay, let's get those colored lights going.
I said that?
I wouldn't be capable of inventing it.
Was that so terrible?
Maybe not. But let's just say it had the effect of a cold shower when I wasn't in the mood for a cold shower.
Oh, I see.
Look, I grant you it was a small straw to be the last straw. Another time it would have bounced right off me. But it had been such a stinker of a day. I got bad notices on the cane book, the deal for the cereal rights fell through, the usual. Except for the fact that I felt a peculiar need that day for some warmth. I guess I felt I needed a wife.
I think I was wifely a lot.
Oh, sure. On and off, in between jokes.
Ooh!
Don't be embarrassed on my account. I'm delighted. I hate a friendly divorce. A lawyer is never entirely comfortable with a friendly divorce, any more than a good mortician wants to finish the job and have the patient sit up on the table. Did you read Walter Lippmann this morning? I thought it was an awfully good piece.
Oscar, don't be urbane all the time.
I can't stand it. Do you see why I don't want to see her again? As soon as you told me she was coming here, she should have walked right out the door. I don't get it. I thought she lost the power to enrage me. I don't know. Maybe I took the bandages off too soon. Maybe I haven't got the... Did you forget something?
No. Damn it, I remembered something. Having made my dramatic exit, I realized this is where I'm being picked up this evening. I have to stay here for another 10 minutes.
I see.
And furthermore, I've had to use your room to change in. Oscar, if the phone rings, will you take it? It may be for me. The Algonquin is supposed to call and confirm my room for this evening.
Well, there's a new telephone in the bedroom.
Never mind about her. We have more important things to talk about. I've now been over all the figures and I'm ready to deliver my State of the Union address.
All right, but tell me about this tax thing first.
Oh, my guess is we ought to get that down somewhere in the neighborhood of $1,800,
$2,000. Well, that would be more like it.
You said you wanted my advice on the overall picture. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you a couple of questions. Tiffany comes from a wealthy family, doesn't she?
What's that got to do with anything?
Well, she has to be supported. You can't support her. I've now been through what we shall laughingly call your books, and you're not supporting yourself.
You're joking.
And why aren't you laughing?
Look, Oscar, if you're trying to tell me in some left-handed way that I can't get married again, you're wasting your time. I'm 36 years old, and this is a
free country, don't you believe it? People pick up the most erroneous ideas from popular songs. Let me tell you something. If all you got is the sun in the morning and the moon at night, you're in big trouble.
What the hell are you talking about? I take $18,000 a year out of this company, plus bonuses.
Right?
Well, that may sound like cigarette change to the Rockefellers, but it still feels pretty good to me. Hell, my father never made more than $5,000 a year in his whole life. And he put 4 boys through college.
Yeah, well, let's not dwell on the glory of the past. I have the figures from this year. Do you want to hear them?
No. I suppose so.
Okay. We'll start with your base salary of $18,000 plus $1,000 sales bonus. By the way, that was down from preceding years.
Sales were down.
That's a total of $19,000. Against that, we have $3,200 rent, $2,080 maid service, $4,900 food and liquor, $5,000 alimony to marriage.
And that's ridiculous. She's working.
That was a decision of the court. You can't do anything about it. $5,000 to marry, $680 club dues and entertainment, $600 clothes, $900 books, furnishings, dry cleaning, $1,100 insurance and medical, $2,700 taxes. We now have a total of $21,210. You do have $3,000 in available savings, but most of that will go for this old tax bill.
Here, let me see that thing.
You can juggle those figures any way you want to. I'm not going to change the basic fact that you're already spending $21,000 on an income of $19,000. It's not just that you can't afford another wife. You'd be ill-advised to buy a canary.
Can't be as complicated as you're pretending.
It's even more complicated. You must keep in mind that if you ever wanted to divorce Tiffany, you'd be in a hopeless position.
Now, why would I want to divorce Tiffany? I'm not going to divorce Tiffany.
Well, your attitude does you credit.
Look, some of these expenses I could shut.
Oh, yes, you can move to a cheaper apartment. You don't have to belong to the New York Athletic Club. You might save $700 or $800. But I have met Tiffany. I doubt that you could keep her in cashmere sweaters for that.
She doesn't work, does she?
She does volunteer things.
Maybe her father would give her an allowance.
Yeah, maybe we'd take in boarders, too. Any more brilliant ideas? Look, what do you want me to do, Oscar? Stay single for the rest of my life and sleep around? Or do I remain celibate and take cold showers and get plenty of exercise?
Fortunately, you belong to the athletic club. Hello? Yes, it is. May I take a message? I see. Would you hold on for a moment? They haven't got a single, but they can give you a suite.
Oh, tell them never mind. I'm not going to pay $24 for one night. I'll go to the Biltmore.
You can stay here. I'm going to be in Goshen all weekend.
Stay here?
You'll be perfectly safe. I won't be here.
I'm not worried. I was perfectly safe when you were here.
I shouldn't have divorced her. I should have shot her.
Thank you. She'll make other arrangements.
With my luck, this will be a telegram telling me that my long-lost uncle just died and left all his money to a kindly waitress. Yet...
Oh, hello again.
Hello. Is she ready?
Is who ready?
Do I get a choice? I'm here for Mary.
For Mary? For what?
For dinner. Isn't that all right? Should my mother have called your mother?
Don't be ridiculous. I just didn't know, that's all.
You see, Bob thinks that when he brings a book back to the library, it'll never go out again.
Bob doesn't think anything. It's just that I always supposed Mr. Winston only went out with women whose names ended in A, like Lava or Ava. And I'm curious to know why he wants to take my former wife to dinner.
Because she looked hungry. You damn fool, because she strikes me as an exceptionally attractive girl.
And you would know.
That's right. I don't want to pull rank or anything, but I think it might be fair to assume that I know at least as much about women as you do about books. Perhaps more.
Oh, you misunderstood me. I'm delighted that you find my former wife attractive. I'm charmed that you're taking her to dinner. If you decide to marry her, I'll send up rockets. In fact, you can count on me as your best man.
Marry her and you count on him as your publisher.
Absolutely! Now there's a brilliant idea. Why do I do that? Asa's got a head on both his shoulders. Look, I can solve your problems, you can solve mine.
You have got to be joking.
Why? This is the age of the deal. You scratch me, I scratch you. Why should I be out of touch? Don't you read the papers?
Bob.
No, let's listen to him. I couldn't be more impressed. It stirs memories of the past. I keep thinking, Louis B. Mayer, thou shouldst be living at this hour.
You see? You're shocked, but he's been around.
And back. It couldn't be more reasonable. He has an unmarketable wife, and I have an unmarketable book. He thinks we should pool our lack of resources. I haven't had such a fascinating offer in years.
Hello? I think I'm all collected. What are you all staring at? Something showing?
Yes, and it looks delicious. Are we ready?
Well, it's all right. Can I pick up that bag later tonight?
Certainly, but how are you going to get in?
I still have my keys. Have you been missing things?
Shall we run along? I double parked down there.
Good night.
Night.
Good night. I think you've got yourself a deal.
I've known you for 20 years and I never realized you had this flair for comedy.
You were joking.
Of course I was joking. Wouldn't I like to see him try? Be an education for him.
No. I don't want to hear another word about my untidy affairs.
What's the matter with you?
Say that I'm weary. Say that I'm sad. Say that health and wealth have missed me, and you said it.
Why are you slashing at those galleries?
Because this man writes like a sick elf!
Thank you.
Did you get wet?
No, except for my hair.
Yeah, it doesn't look wet.
No, but you watch. In 5 minutes, it'll be so fuzzy, I'll be able to cut a piece off and clean my suede shoes.
Would you feel safer if I left the door open?
Oh, dear. I felt perfectly safe until you asked that question.
All right, that question is withdrawn.
Oh, isn't this the silliest snowstorm?
I don't know. I come from California. I think it's a lovely snowstorm.
No, but those great big flakes swirling around. It looks so foamy. Like, do you remember those big glass paperweights when you turn them upside down and it snows? It looks like that. Oh. Here's that jam bag. Now, remember, you're not coming back out with me. I'll get a cab.
In this? You'd never. And besides, here I am, ready, willing, cheaper.
If I had a brain in my head, I'd have taken it with me, and we could have dropped it off at the Biltmore.
Does everybody tell you how pretty you are?
You are a good actor. You can play anything. You know what? Billy Idiotic are going back out in that blizzard. We're not delivering the serum or anything. Why don't I just stay here? He's safely in Goshen with a beautiful, lovely girl with a head on her shoulders.
Do you suppose we can have a drink, or did Bob get custody of the liquor?
Sure, let's have a drink. But make mine light. I'm beginning to feel that champagne.
All right.
We must have been 3 hours in that restaurant. That's the nice thing about having dinner with somebody you're not married to. We have so much more to talk about.
All I found out about you is that you're allergic to penicillin and that you love Catcher in the Rye.
That's all? That's a lot. I want to hear about you. Are you going to get your book published?
I am going to make every possible effort. Here, that's mostly water.
Thanks.
Well, you and Bob must have spent a lot of time with authors. What do they talk about?
You don't think they talk about books? They talk about first serial rights, second serial rights, movie rights, how they're going to form a corporation to publish their next one so they can call it a capital gain and move to Jamaica.
They sound just like actors.
Terrible when you think of writers trying out his material on you. You never know exactly what reaction they expect, but you have to keep looking so interested that your eyebrows get tired.
I know this guy who used to work for Disney. He could tell you the plot of an animated cartoon frame by frame. Yeah, but he was a classic case. I mean, he could bore the birds back onto the trees. Yeah, he never stopped talking, never. Oh, and when he took a drink, he put his hand up like this. And so you couldn't put a word in until he was back with you. Your eyes are so dark and so liquid, I feel they might spill right down your cheeks.
That's because I need glasses and I won't wear them.
Now, why do you do that?
Do what?
You jump when you get a compliment.
No, I don't.
You're actually embarrassed.
Why should I be embarrassed?
I don't know, but you are. You come bustling in to change the subject, like a nervous hostess who's just discovered that two of the guests are quarreling.
No, come along, Henry. There's somebody very nice I want you to meet.
All right. Pay me pretty compliments and I won't change the subject.
And you won't make jokes?
What?
Shouldn't I have said that?
Oh, no, that's all right. It's been said before. Just recently, in fact. I suppose I should take a course and find out what a girl should answer when a gentleman says, "Tell me, pretty maiden, are there any more at home like you?" Though it hardly pay, it doesn't come up that often.
I thought little girls learned things like that when they were 3 years old.
Oh, but I'm a very retarded case. Since only just this year, I learned how to put my hair up in rollers.
What did you do before that?
I wore it pinned back in a bun. When it had to be cut, I cut it, or I went somewhere and they cut it. But lately, I've been going to Elizabeth Arden, and I want you to know it's a whole new way of life.
So I'm told.
At Arden's, they don't just cut your hair. Never. They shave it. And they honestly believe a good shaving is as important as a cure for cancer. The hairdresser really blanched when he saw my bun. I could almost hear him thinking, "Thank God she came to me. Another month and it might have been too late."
Well, I think your hair looks lovely. Now say thank you.
Thank you.
You see how easy it is?
I would like to hear about your book.
What can I say? All right. It weighs 3/4 of a pound. It takes 84 cents in stamps to mail it.
Oh, don't talk like that. You mustn't lose faith in it just because Bob didn't like it. I mean, he's a good publisher, but he makes mistakes. Did you have any help with this book?
You mean, did I tell it to somebody? No.
Oh, I'm glad. All of these as-told-to books have such a spooky flavor about them. First, all the personality is drained off, and then to compensate, something else is pumped in, you know, sex or religion or Scott Fitzgerald. I fully expect any day now we're going to have the Confessions of St. Augustine as told to Walter Cronkite.
Mary, you just said that Bob makes mistakes, but how did he ever let you slip through his fingers?
Oh, just lucky, I guess.
You know, I think I'm beginning to see the clue to this little puzzle.
What puzzle?
You.
Oh, I would love to think I was a puzzle. A woman of mystery, smiling and enigmatic on the surface, but underneath a tiger. No, I hate to admit it, but what you see is all there is. Underneath this plain girlish exterior, there's a very plain girl.
Ah, but what happened to make you decide that it was such a plain exterior was the divorce, wasn't it? It was Bob.
Bob? Mm-hmm. No. I decided that when I was 13 years old. Can't blame Bob for everything.
At 13, all by yourself, you decided that?
Well, no, there were people around, but I can't say they gave me any argument. Do you ever look at little girls?
How little?
Well, you take two little girls. One of them, pink and brown, with curly hair and yards of eyelashes. And the other one is pale and bony, with thin, wispy hair and two little ears poking through, like candles on a sugar bowl. Okay, which one of these little girls is going to have to wear braces on her teeth?
The wispy one?
You got it. That was me. Braces on my teeth, band-aids on my knees, freckles on my nose, all elbows and shoulder blades. For 2 years running, I got picked to play the consumptive orphan in Michael O'Halloran.
That was talent.
No, that was typecasting.
All adolescents go through something. I had the worst case of acne in the history of the world. For 3 years, I was a Technicolor marvel. Well, you wouldn't remember when Fleischmann's yeast was the big thing, but I used to eat Fleischmann's yeast and drink water until I couldn't move without gurgling. I mean, I imagined I was actually fermenting.
Well, I never ate yeast, but once I sent away secretly for Stillman's freckle cream, but I must have used too much because I just peeled and peeled. I had to pretend it was a sunburn.
I used to pretend I hated everybody, especially girls, because I was too self-conscious to talk to them.
You made a spectacular recovery.
Well, I may even have overdone it, but why didn't you?
Make a recovery? Well, with me, it was different. I mean, when I was a kid, I never thought about the way I looked because I knew I would grow up to be beautiful, just like my sister Clara.
Was she so beautiful?
Clara? Oh, she had bright red hair and green eyes. Joe's had this faintly startled look as though she'd just come out of a dark movie theater into the sunlight. People who met her would be so busy staring, they'd forget to finish their sentences.
I can see that would have been something of a cross for you.
No, I thought it was insurance. Clara was 6 years older than I was, and I thought, I'll grow up to look just like that. And then one day, I was measuring myself, and I hadn't grown an inch, not in a whole year. And then it came to me, I wasn't going to grow anymore, and I didn't look anything at all like Clara.
And you weren't satisfied to look like Mary?
I certainly was not. I ran to my father and said, when am I going to look like Clara? Poor man, he didn't know what to say.
What did he say?
He said, oh, honey, we wouldn't want two Claras. You're the bright one. Well, that did it. You know, I could have handled being plain, but to be plain and bright. In the high school I went to, that was a beatable combination.
So you decided to get on the debating team.
How did you know?
Girls who think they aren't going to get invited to dances always get on the debating team.
And I worked on the school newspaper.
Oh.
And I imagined all the time that I
really Catherine Earnshaw.
Catherine who?
Kathy, the girl in Wuthering Heights.
Oh, Merle Oberon.
That's right.
Yeah.
Oh, I used to dream that somewhere there was a strange, dark man whose heart was quietly breaking for me. On rainy nights, I'd open my window and imagine I could hear him calling me. Oh, my wild, sweet Kathy. Oh, the cold I got. And of course, the only dark man I ever saw was the middle-aged dentist who used to adjust the braces on my teeth.
And you're still cross about it.
Is that how I sound?
Mm-hmm.
No, I feel wistful. I think of that sappy little girl, and I wonder what happened to her.
Nothing happened to her. She hasn't changed at all.
You mean I haven't changed at all? That's a hell of a thing to say.
I'm certain you've changed in appearance. That's clear enough. But you yourself haven't changed. Somewhere inside you, you're still wearing braces on your teeth.
Oh, come, come. I came to the big city. I learned to tip waiters. I read The New Yorker. I got married.
And nothing took. You know what's strange?
What?
Here you are, so lovely. And no one falls in love with you.
Oh, is that so? And where do you get that idea?
From you.
You're crazy. I never said... Listen, lots of people... Well, certainly Bob was in love with me.
Oh, you really thought so?
Well, of course. Why else would he marry me? There was no dowry or anything.
I don't know. Why did he?
Well, because he felt... Because we both felt... Listen, what is this? I haven't answered so many idiotic questions since I tried to open a charge account. It's that. Must be a ladylike, genteel way of telling you. It's none of your damn business.
I knew I'd get a rise out of you when I said that about Bob.
Well, then why did you say it?
Of course, Bob was in love with you, but you didn't believe it. You still don't believe it.
Well, what did he tell you?
Nothing. You're the evidence. Women who think they're attractive have a certain air about them. You don't. Your reflexes are off.
I will match my reflexes with your manners any old day. And now, unless you have some other speech all prepared, I suggest you go upstairs or downstairs or wherever it is you call home.
Oh, now you're mad?
Oh, you are the quick one. Nothing's wasted on you. Of course I'm mad. What did you expect I'd be?
I didn't know. I've never met anybody quite like you before.
Well, we're even. I've never met anybody like you either. Which doesn't explain why I let myself be taken in by that richer, milder, longer-lasting MGM charm.
Oh, were you taken in?
Well, I must have been. Why else would I sit here, babbling like an idiot, pouring out my girlish secrets? This is not part of my regular act. I will never learn. I will never learn.
Mary, you know what I feel? I feel
you
as if...
You feel as though you were seeing me for the first time.
I'll tell you something you ought to learn. You really ought to learn when to shut up. Now, once more, quickly, before you lose your nerve.
I feel dizzy.
Well, that's suitable.
Well, it's just that I haven't kissed anybody in so long, but it's like riding a bicycle. It does come back to you.
And you don't even have to worry about the calories.
You know, you're very nice, and about 95% correct.
About what?
About a lot of things. But why are you bothering with me?
I'm being bribed.
Well, I knew that. But I mean, there must be other reasons. Like for me, I like you because you made me lose my temper.
And that's a reason?
To me, it is. I've gone so long not reacting to anything. It's somehow reassuring. Like, if you were absolutely convinced that you had no feeling left in your hand, you'd be relieved to burn your fingers.
Oh, now what can we do for those fingers?
And Mary, I like you because I think with any encouragement, I might fall in love with you. But now, if you're going to say anything, say what you're thinking. Don't invent something.
Okay. I'm thinking I would really like to believe that, so I will.
That's my girl. rhetorical questions. You can see what she's doing here.
Well, all I meant was to indicate my surprise that Mary was here. I mean, I thought we left that you were staying at the Biltmore. What's the situation now?
No, I mean,
are you just coming or going?
Well, I'm staying. What about you?
We thought you were on your way to Goshen.
I was on my way to Goshen, but there's a blizzard out there. Couldn't even get on the thruway.
I wasn't privy to your change of plans. Do you know I have never used that word privy before in my whole life?
Not even 20?
No, never. Don't you hate places that have cute names for the men's room?
I hate places that have cute names for the places. Yeah. Did you ever hear of a nightclub called the Shea Wen?
No.
What is it called when the words in a sentence are accidentally twisted, like where the preacher says that the Lord is a shoving leopard?
I think that's a spoonerism.
Oh, right.
I always get words twisted like that. I was buying a hammock for the porch at home, and in a crowded elevator I said, "Miss, where do you have the perch furniture?"
Perch furniture?
Don't you just know the unsuitable things that go on in perch furniture?
Bob, why don't you get yourself a drink?
Thank you. You're the soul of hospitality.
Boy, you're just standing there.
Well, don't mind Bob. It's just that he's systematic. He has his day all planned out. He makes a list. And the snow wasn't on his list, and you weren't on his list.
Really? And I thought we had such an interesting chat at 6 o'clock. I thought it was definitely in his plans.
On his list.
Look, I'm sorry if I sounded rude, but it's 1:30 in the morning, and any hour now I'd like to know where I'm going to lay my head. Did I understand you to say that you were staying here?
Yes, I'm sleepy. I do not wish to go out into the night that covers me black as the pit from pole to pole. Remember, women and children first, that's the law of the sea. I'm sure it goes for snowstorms.
Well, naturally, I don't expect you to go out in this. Would it be all right if I slept here on the couch?
Well, certainly. Be your guest.
Our host is beginning to look glassy-eyed, and since we seem to be sitting on his final resting place, I think I'd better leave. But it was a lovely evening.
Oh, I thought so. I really thought so.
I'll call you first thing in the morning. Is 10 o'clock too early?
Oh, no. 10 o'clock's fine.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Night.
Well, I'll just get myself some sheets and a blanket. Yes, the extra blanket is still here in the storage closet.
I guess.
Oh, here it is. Man, we can't open a window. The place is full of smoke.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I must say I'm rather surprised at you.
Yes, I'm a little surprised to meet you.
You've been drinking.
Yep, that's exactly what I've been doing. You know, it's taught me a valuable lesson. You know what's the matter with this country? Too much sobriety. Too many sober persons.
May I suggest that you get straight to bed before you pass right out there on the floor?
No, you may not suggest one thing. I do not require your solicitude.
Solicitude? Solicitude.
It's all right. That is what I do not require. I feel fine, splendid, top of the morning.
Oh. I thought you were the slow to warm up type, Miss Bird's Eye Frozen.
Yes, there was a rumor like that going round. Isn't it nice to know there's nothing in it?
Look, Mary, what you do is none of my business. I know that.
I'm glad you know that.
Well, I never expected that you would retire to the convent. You should go out with other men. You should get married again to some man who's in love with you.
What other kind of man would marry me?
Well, there are men and men. Let me tell you, you don't know what you're getting into here. The idea of you sitting around necking with that bum. I mean, what the hell do you know about him anyway?
Well, let's see. He had a very bad case of acne when he was 14 years old.
That clarifies everything.
Hey, wait, you leave here, dearie. These boys, these glamour boys, collect women like stamps. If you want to be added to the collection.
All right, I'll tell you something. He thinks he's falling in love with me.
He told you that? Oh, that bastard.
But of course you didn't believe him.
Well, why not?
Well, come on, Mary. Does it seem very likely that that big caramel-colored movie idol would walk in here and 1, 2, 3, bang, fall in love with a girl like you?
I guess I thought it was possible, yes. Even with a girl like me.
Oh, I didn't mean a girl like you. I meant any
older. Oh, no, I know what you meant. How could you be clearer? I'm the drab, colorless type who should know better than to believe it when somebody tells me I'm pretty.
Are you going to cry about it?
Maybe. Maybe. Why not?
Because you never cry.
How do you know I never? How do you know? I'll cry if I please. And I please.
Mary?
Don't you marry me.
I don't get it. Must be the position of the moon. Some joker tells you you're beautiful and you go all to pieces. I used to tell you were beautiful all the time and your detachment was marvelous to behold.
You never, never, never told me I was beautiful.
Of course I did.
No, you didn't. You said you liked the way I look.
That's the same thing.
Oh, certainly it's not the same thing. The world is full of people you like the way they look, but you wouldn't say they were beautiful.
Like who, for instance?
Like Mrs. Roosevelt.
You don't think Mrs. Roosevelt is beautiful? My God, the character in that face.
See? Now I'm a communist. I'm picking on Mrs. Roosevelt. I love Mrs. Roosevelt. And I'm not talking about character. If there is one thing I don't need any more of, there's one thing I'm lousy with, it's character. Why did you come back here tonight? I felt so good, and now everything is spoiled.
Look, I can see you're upset. I'm sorry about
it. You're not sorry. You're merely embarrassed.
What I am is surprised. I never thought I'd find you sobbing on the sofa for all the world like any other woman. It's actually quite becoming.
Thank you. I'm so relieved to know that.
Funny you never cried in the 5 years we were married.
I figured you were sensitive enough for both of us. You decided right from the beginning that I was the airy type, impervious to wind and weather and small disappointments.
You sound like I invented your character. And for that matter, what's wrong with being the airy type?
Well, it got to be a bit of a strain. I felt like I was on some damn panel show 24 hours a day, smiling and affable, humming little snatches of song, laughing when I didn't know the answer, but affable, affable, affable. You don't know how I long some morning to get up and feel free for once to be to be constipated. To be boring. All right, I was boring.
No, you were never boring. It's funny, we talked so much without communicating.
Well, it was hard to communicate with you. You were always communicating with yourself. The line was busy.
Is that the way it seemed to you?
It seemed to me like you were taking your emotional temperature 6 times a day. I could almost hear you asking yourself, am I tense? Am I nervous? Did that upset me? In fact, how are you feeling right now?
No, it's true. I have a bad habit of asking myself questions. But am I tense? Am I nervous? That's more or less reasonable. It was far more foolish than that. I used to ask myself, why doesn't she love me?
You asked yourself that?
All the time.
That's why I hate intellectuals. They're all so dumb!
What kind of a statement is that?
That's an idiotic statement. I should save my breath and realize I'm talking to the most sensible man in the Western Hemisphere.
Why do you keep harping on that? I'm not all that sensible.
But you are. You lead a sensible life. You eat a sensible breakfast. You limit yourself to one pack of cigarettes a day, no more than 2 cocktails before dinner. You're even sensible about sex.
Would you care to explain that track?
Any man who would tap his wife on the shoulder at 11 o'clock and say, are you in the mood tonight? Because if you're not, I'm going to take a sleeping pill, is about as sensible as you can get.
Well, of course I don't have Dirk Winton's techniques in these matters.
No, you don't. More's the pity.
Look, I didn't mean to bring out your heavy artillery. I just wanted to save you from a...
What? From Dirk? But I don't want to be saved.
Wait a minute. Are you sure you don't think...
If he's just toying with my affections, maybe I'm in the mood to have my affections toyed with.
Look, Mary, you don't have the whole picture.
No, but I've seen the previews. And there's not one thing in this whole world you could do about it.
I'm ashamed to tell you this, but I have
to... No, you don't have to, and you're not going to. I won't listen. I had a lovely time. A lovely time, you hear? And you're not going to spoil it for me. Good night.
Yes. Mr. Winston's apartment, please. Dirk. Bob. You asleep? No, I didn't call to find out if you were asleep. I'm coming down there. I have to talk to you. Who's there with you? Your agent. Is she pretty? No, I'm sorry. Look, then you come up here. Relax, as if I'm asking you to drive to New Rochelle. It's one flight up. No, it can't wait till month. Look, it'll only take 5 minutes, okay? Okay.
Do you want the arm or shall I keep it?
Oh, no, you keep it. I'm hardly likely to oversleep on the damn sofa.
You're lucky if I get to sleep at all.
Right, I'll take the sofa. It doesn't bother me.
No, absolutely not. Now, you're going to bed? Would you, go to bed?
What is the matter with you? Why are you so jumpy?
I'm waiting for you to go to bed! Instead of which, what are you doing?
I'm looking for something to read.
The place is wall-to-wall books. What do you want?
I want something guaranteed not to improve my mind. The Riddle of Real Teeth? The Gathering Storm? Wow! Dirk's book! The very thing!
Okay, now we go to bed.
Going!
No, don't hit that damn buzzer!
What's the problem? I simply don't want Mary to hear the bell, that's all. Shall I come in?
Certainly, come in.
Listen, you want a drink?
No, I do not want a drink. I really want to know why you hauled me up here in the middle of the night.
Well, it's only 2 o'clock. Look, I really think that we ought to, what I mean is, you and I really should... Are you sure you don't want a drink?
Positive.
Well, I want a drink.
All right, let's have it.
All right, now look here, Winston. You know damn well that all that talk about you and Mary and my publishing your book was supposed to be a joke.
I thought it was funny.
All right, you knew I wasn't serious.
You were serious. You had the wild-eyed look of a man who has just spoken a true word in jest.
I shot off my face. A bad habit I must live in full bloom. However, I wish to make it absolutely clear that I never intended at any time to make a deal with you concerning Mary.
And I thought it was an admirable plan. You wouldn't have been losing a wife. You'd have been gaining an author.
But we have the whole thing straight now?
Certainly.
Good. I certainly never dreamt that you were this anxious to get into print. And I never thought that Mary, of all people, would sink into girlish incoherence at her first exposure to an actor.
Why do you say, of all people, Mary?
Because she's got some sense. That she could swallow that corny line of yours.
Do you describe everything you don't understand as corny?
What's that supposed to mean?
Nothing. I suppose I can go now, or did you have some other little confidence to tell me?
No. And thank you for coming. You see, I had to straighten this whole thing out. I'll make your excuses to Mary in the morning.
You will what?
I'll tell her you had to go back to Hollywood for retakes, or whatever you go back to Hollywood for.
And why will you tell her that?
Oh, come on! You don't think you're going to be doing her a kindness to continue this little farce, do you?
I am not interested in doing her a kindness, and I am going to see her again.
Wait a minute. I thought we understood each other. I thought we talked things out.
Yes, and you listened very carefully to every word you had to say.
What is that supposed to mean?
It means you should take that paper bag off your head. You notice everything but the obvious. What kind of a jerk are you? How dare you suppose that Mary is some kind of charity case? How do you get up to suggest that any man interested in her has to have at least three ulterior motives?
I never thought that.
Yeah, well, you give a very good impersonation of a person who thought that. What I told Mary may very well have sounded corny. Seems I lacked literary qualities everywhere. But it wasn't a line. You know, talking to you, I begin to understand why Mary is so shy.
Mary shy?
That's right, shy and insecure. But you probably don't believe that either, even though you're at least two-thirds responsible.
How can I be responsible for that?
I don't know. My guess is that you treated her as though she were intelligent.
That's because she is intelligent!
She'll hear you. Where did you get the habit of making assumptions based on assumptions? Was your father a lawyer?
I'll put it all in a letter.
Right? Now, before I go, I want to say only one thing. Leave her alone. Just leave her alone, okay? I mean, tonight.
Are you nuts? I'm getting married in 2 weeks.
Dandy. I'll send you a pair of bookends.
Operator, could you ring this number? Yes, my number. Thank you. Mary, this is Bob. I'm in the living room. I wasn't going to go barging into the bedroom. Look, I had something to say, and I didn't see any reason why I couldn't say it on the phone.
I'll go back in. You call me.
No, wait, stop. Stay right there.
I feel like I have an obligation to tell you, in all fairness, that I was apparently wrong about Mr. Winston.
By what curious process did you arrive at this conclusion?
I talked to him. He was just here.
He wasn't.
It's all right. He merely told me that I was an insensitive clunk who never appreciated you.
What did you say?
A number of stupid things. It was not my finest hour. Of course, when he said I didn't appreciate you, that's hogwash. I appreciated you all right. I just couldn't handle you.
Berate yourself. I didn't win any medals for the way I handled you. It takes at least one to make a marriage.
Look, do you know how you feel when you have a full cup of coffee in your hand and you start to sneeze? There's nothing to do but just let it splash? Well, that's how I feel in all my relationships anymore. Helpless, unable to coordinate, splashing everybody.
You're just tired.
You should have heard my various exchanges with Winston today, and thank God you didn't. My God, talk about a comedy of errors. You know, I try to grasp all sides of the picture. Nobody believes that, but I tried.
Bob, honey. I mean, Bob, I certainly believe it. I honestly think you're so busy grasping all sides of the picture, you never stand back and see it.
Okay, give me an example.
Okay, well, I've been reading Dirk's book, and I haven't gotten very far, but it's good.
Come on.
No, you're going to let me finish. Now, it may not win a Pulitzer Prize, but it's readable. It is so nice and gossipy. I think it would sell.
Well, I never said it wouldn't sell. I just said I didn't want to do it.
But why not?
We've been through this 100 times.
Bob, you're not going to believe this, but I'm glad you have standards. I wouldn't want you to settle for trash, but it's no crime to stay in business. Got to keep the shop open or you won't be there when a masterpiece comes along. Let me get it. I'm willing to make a small bet that you can open it anywhere and find something that's nice and interesting. I mean, maybe it goes to pieces at the end, but I wouldn't know about that. So, let's just open it anywhere. Starlets have a reputation for being dumb only because they have such blank expressions. And the smarter they are, the blanker they look, because they've learned that it's impossible to register any emotion without using some muscle which in time will produce a wrinkle. Even to look a tiny bit puzzled causes twin lines over the bridge of the nose. By the time she's 30, a starlet has been carefully taught to smile like a dead halibut. The eyes widen, the jaw drops open, but the eye muscles are never involved. See, they don't go like this. See all those wrinkles? They go like this. You don't think that's funny?
Haven't you got a robe you could put on?
What do you mean, haven't I got a robe?
Well, do you think it's all right to be sitting there in your night clothes?
My night clothes? Good Lord, you think this is a black lace bikini? 8 million times you've seen me in pajamas.
We were married then.
Okay, look at it this way. The divorce won't be final for 2 weeks.
That may be precisely the point.
Oh, my, you are so proper. Do you feel yourself in danger of being compromised? But don't worry so much. If I should suddenly throw myself on you, you could always scream.
Shut up.
It happens. I don't have a robe, but there must be something around. Oh, yes. Here we are. I trust this will show my good faith and restore your sense of fitness.
And how do you think you look in that?
Oh, I don't know. Kind of cute, maybe?
Oh, you're cocky all of a sudden.
All of a sudden? It took months. It was work, work, work every minute.
But it's been worth it. Think of having Dirk Winston make passes at you. It must be like getting a good housekeeping seal of approval.
Sort of.
When you kissed him, I hope you didn't damage his porcelain crowns.
Well, we can't worry about everything. But never mind his crowns, I want to talk about his book.
I'm not going to talk to you about anything in that damn coat. You look like Jackie Coogan and the kid. Take it off.
Oh, no, no, please.
Stop it. You're just trying to make me feel foolish.
You're going to break the buttons.
The hell with the buttons! No. That's as far as I mean to go. Now, would you do me a favor, please? Please, please go to bed.
Certainly, but what are you so intense about?
You're having intense time! Believe it, I've done that before! I'm asking myself how I feel, and I feel wretched!
Well, what's the matter?
Oh, you know damn well what's the matter. I feel all involved again. And I won't have it, I will not have it! God, I was getting over you so nicely. I was cured. My God! I feel like someone who just got out of the hospital after 9 long runs and fell down in the lobby and broke his leg! And you did it deliberately!
Did it? Did what?
Oh, if you want to stand there and pretend like your only purpose in the last half hour was to change my opinion about that book, fine.
I gather I'm not fooling you, great student of character that you are.
Well, what were you trying to do? Sitting there in the sofa, curling up cute as all get out in your pink little pajamas. No, I'll tell you what you were trying to do. You were conducting a little experiment.
I was?
Oh, you just wanted to see, for old time's sake, if old Bob wouldn't leap at the bait like our friend Mr. Winston. You wanted to see if there weren't just any little twinges left. Well?
Well, I'm just wondering if that could possibly be true.
Well, I don't see any reason to keep you in suspense. Yes, if you want to know! I do still feel twinges! By God, every now and then I feel a sharp one! Now what do you say?
Well, I don't know. Sounds like a gallbladder attack. Bob, where are you going?
Where am I going? Out! What am I going to do?
you worry your pretty little head over me.
No, and don't tell me.
should have explained last night, Tiffany, that you'd find Mary here this morning. Of course, I didn't know last night. I suppose you've introduced yourselves.
Oh, yes, of course.
Good morning, Mary.
Good morning, Bob. Did you have to go without your overcoat?
At the time, I thought so.
Well, I made up your bed because I expected... Well, what did you do?
Walk, mostly.
Don't tell me you're out of cigarettes, too.
Yes, but you'll find some there in the top.
No, I looked.
Well, did you look behind
you? Yes, I checked the bar and the last refuge of all, the Chinese base.
Don't tell me I'm going to have to go trudging back out in the snow for a pack of cigarettes.
Just for a cigarette? Oh, would you like some breakfast? We have some orange-flavored yogurt.
Oh, no, Lord. Tiffany, be a lamb and roll up those sheets, will you? There may be some
other... If you hadn't dumped every single ashtray last night, I might have found some medium-sized butts.
We must remain calm. It's statistically impossible that in this entire big apartment there's not one single... Well, just ask yourself, if you were a cigarette, where would you go?
Success!
There, did you ever see anything so pretty in your life? Oh, but they're all squashed.
That's real coffee.
Oh, coffee? Oh, what's that about coffee?
Nothing, absolutely nothing.
Oh, it must be something.
Well, we heard this announcer on television late at night one night, and, well, I guess the poor joker was so confused and talking about so many different products all day long. Anyway, he was doing a cigarette commercial, and, he sucked in and smiled and said,
that's real coffee.
You see, I told you it wasn't worth going into. All of which reminds me, I haven't had any coffee this morning. I guess I'll go start some up.
Well, how long does it take to have private little jokes?
What?
Oh, never mind. I must stop asking questions for which there are no answers. You know, this sheet isn't even must. Nobody slept on the sofa last night.
Oh, no, Bob was going to, but he
changed his mind.
Oh, well, that couch is a little short for him, but anyway, he decided that
he'd rather sleep with you.
You mean for old time's sake? No, indeed. Bob went, well, I don't know exactly where he went, but he certainly wasn't here, as you will discover when you ask him.
Oh, I won't ask him.
Because you don't believe me?
No, I don't.
Tiffany, when you get a little older, you'll learn not to invent problems. All you have to do is wait, and real ones turn up.
Well, I think I'm glad it happened.
You are.
Well, Bob's attitude towards you has always been a little mysterious. I'm hoping this may clear the air.
Your theory is that he's a little bit homesick, and a trip back to the old place may cure him?
All right, yes, that's what I think.
Bob, I'm afraid our little secret is out.
What little secret?
Oh, no, Bob, please. Tiffany knows, and she's being very understanding.
Would you care to be plainer? I'm simply not up to riddles this morning.
Certainly. I'm trying to tell you that Tiffany is glad we slept together last night. I think we'll clear the air.
What did you say? What?
I really must get dressed.
Did I understand her correctly?
Bob, whatever you do, please don't apologize.
You're damn right I'm not going to apologize.
All right, but are you going to snap at me?
Wait a minute. You accept this as fact and you're not even disturbed?
Well, should I be?
Well, I can think of six reasons why you ought to be. You can't think of one?
Well, it's not like it was somebody new. You fall into an old situation and into an old pattern.
I see.
Well, anybody will tell you that the forced habit is stronger than love, even.
And despite the fact that I shack up with my ex-wife, you're still willing to marry me.
Certainly.
My God, don't you have any principles, any ethics?
Well, not if my ethics ever get involved in this. What have I done?
Oh, my God. I gotta take some aspirin. I gotta clear my head.
Well, what's the matter?
You've heard of a lost weekend? Well, this has been a found weekend, and it's worse.
Well, guess what?
I got a feeling in my bones that this is gonna be one little peach of a day. I gotta take something to clear my head off and make some dreadful mistake and try to get her. And where the hell is Oscar?
Oscar? What do you want with Oscar on a Sunday?
Here.
Also take two of those large vitamins.
Mm-hmm. Why?
Well, alcohol works directly on the bloodstream, and if you drink too much, it lowers the white count, which is one reason why you should.
No! Spare me the details. There, that day three. I can feel my white blood count going up already.
Bob, you didn't take these, did you?
You told me to.
You idiot, these aren't vitamins.
What are they?
Sleeping pills.
Oh, great, just great.
Do you feel peculiar?
Yet!
Oh, well, you will be better at something.
Tiffany! Not gonna kill me.
Take a whole bottle of 120 or something. That'll be Oscar. Would you get that for me?
Don't sit down!
Why?
You see, you're supposed to keep moving around.
Tiffany, you're thinking about a concussion!
Oh! Hello, you're the Winston!
Yes, and you are...
I'm Tiffany Richards! And we've got a problem. Bob is taking some sleeping pills.
Bob has.
Tiffany, don't turn this into a melodrama.
Do you think you could get him some coffee? I'm going to run to the drugstore to see if I can get some no-dose or Benzedrine.
They're not
going to
give you that without a prescription.
Oh, they'll give me something. Don't you worry. You'll watch for him, won't you?
Like a mother. Now, don't worry. Why did you do it?
Because my life had suddenly turned to ashes. I didn't know which way to turn.
Come off it. How many did you take?
Three. Look, I thought I was taking vitamins. I mixed the bottles up. Any more questions?
Yeah. Who's Mary?
Well, the last time I saw her, she was in her pajamas. So I think we can safely assume that she's dressing.
What the hell are you so irritable about?
I had a rotten life. Slept a little and I drank too much.
Well, you're not fooling anybody. You're mad as a hornet because I'm here to get married.
Why should I be mad? I'm delighted.
You sound delighted.
Never mind my inflections. I just haven't had your training.
You know, there's something very mysterious about your feelings for Mary. It's like gas. You can't get it up and you can't get it down.
There's a touch of poet in you.
Good morning.
Good morning. You just getting up?
No, I've been up for an hour already. I've had time for a heart-to-heart talk with Miss Richards.
I'm glad I have to have some coffee. I gotta clear my head.
Could you bring me some dish, please? And a Danish?
Drop down the middle, no butter, I'll get it.
I woke up this morning thinking what a nice thing just happened to me, and it was you.
You're very sweet, and not at all like a movie actor.
Sure I am. Movie actors are just ordinary, mixed-up people with agents.
I should think it would be fun to be Jern Winston.
Oh, it is. There are all kinds of advantages. I can go into any restaurant at all, and the head waiter will automatically bring me a large peppermill. Doctors don't get peppermills. Oh, lawyers. Not only that, but the head waiter stands right there until I use it. I mean, I don't want it to feel like a failure, so I grind away. With the result that I've had too much pepper on everything for the past 20 years. I love the way you smile.
Oh. Dirk, you know, I want you to know I will never forget last evening. You couldn't possibly know what you've done for me.
Yes, but what have I done for you lately?
Oh, no, I'm not joking. I'm terribly pleased and gratified.
Gratified? Hell, I don't want you to be gratified. I want you to be interested. I want you to tell me it would cause you a real pang if you thought you weren't going to see me again.
Oh, Dirk, it would. And it does.
I got a call from the studio at 8 o'clock. They insist that I fly to New Orleans this morning for some personal appearance stuff. That picture of mine is opening there on Thursday.
In New Orleans?
Yes, it's called The King of the Mardi Gras. You see, that's the way the great minds in publicity operate. The mayor meets me at the airport and he hands me a praline or some damn thing. I mean, there's nothing I can do about it. It's in my contract. Anyway, here's the point. Why don't you come with me?
Dirk, I'm a working girl.
Oh, surely they can carry on without you for 1 week. Never underestimate the power of the Ladies' Home Journal.
But you just don't do that.
Sure you do. You call them up and you tell them you just had a recurrence of an old football injury. We could have a lot of fun. We could get to know each other.
But Dirk, I don't go off on trips with movie stars. I read about people like that in the Journal American and I'm scandalized.
Come on, be rash. Fly now, pay later.
Dirk. Could you do me a big favor? We seem to be all out of everything. Could you go down to the bakery and get me a half dozen of Danish? It's for Mary.
No, let's have toast, anything.
No, we're all out of everything.
Well, I don't have all that time.
I go myself, but I feel so groggy. It's right in the building. Go left out of the elevator.
Well, I started life as a messenger boy.
No, don't bother.
No, it's all right. I have to check to see if they have my luggage downstairs in the lobby anyway. Mary, think about it.
Oh, I don't know who ate them, but there was a whole bag full last night.
I stuffed them in the trash.
What?
I wanted to get rid of them so I could talk to you.
That is a dumb thing. Why should he have to...
It'll be all right. Leave him alone. Look, Mary, I'd like to shake you until your teeth rattle.
Oh, come on. In your whole life, you never even shook a bottle of magnesia.
Why? Why? Why would you tell Tiffany that we slept together last night?
This, but I said nothing to give her that impression.
Well, why did she?
I don't know. Some people have such a talent for making the best of a bad situation that they go around creating bad situations so they can make the best of them.
She didn't seem to be upset at all.
Upset? I got the impression she was delighted.
I know. I don't understand it. I don't understand anything anymore. Oh, Mary, I'm so miserable.
Why?
Why? You should know why. Look, in the past 9 months since we've been separated, have you been happier?
No.
Have you ever thought we might get back together again?
Cross my mind.
Would you consider it?
Oh, Bob, do you know what you're saying? Do you mean it?
Yes. I do mean it. I've been behaving like a damned adolescent, refusing to face the simple facts.
So what simple facts?
Well, let's look at the whole thing in sequence. A, I wanted a divorce from you because, well, it boils down to something as simple as I didn't think you understood me. Okay. B, as soon as we separated, I realized what I should have known all along. I'm the kind of man that has to be married.
Oh, is that what you realized?
Oh, absolutely. This business of flying from flower to flower never did appeal to me. I hate to live alone. I hate to sleep alone. I find myself at 4 o'clock in the morning sitting alone in the bathroom reading old magazines. So I decided to get married again. That's it. At the time, it seemed like the logical thing to do.
I'd say so, yes.
Now, wait a minute. Now I discover that Tiffany actually believes that I would sleep with one woman on the eve of marrying another. She should know me better than that by now. It's not in my character. I'm way too square. But the point remains, she doesn't understand me either.
Okay, we've had A, B, and C. What about D?
Oh, well, I ask myself, am I walking with my eyes wide open into another case of incompatibility? In 5 years, is there going to be another divorce? I don't think I can handle it.
No, and there would be more alimony, too.
Poor alimony, poor Steve. Poor confusion. You see, the thing is, you and I may be incompatible, but by now we know all about it. I think we should get married again. I think it would be the logical, the sensible thing to do, don't you?
You... clunk. You're a block of wood. You're dumb. You're obtuse. Do you know something? I was so much in love with you that when you left, I thought I'd die. That's right. Big, healthy Mary. I thought I might just possibly die. In the beginning, I slept with the light on because I'd wake up in the dark and reach out for you. Do you know if I saw a man in the like you, who walk like you. I used to feel faint, really faint. Then you have the gall to stand here and tell me the sensible reasons why I should come back to you? You and your damn stinking ABC.
Wait a minute, just because I try to be rational doesn't mean I don't feel anything.
No, we won't really know until after the autopsy. I'm going to give you some advice. I think you should go right ahead and marry Tiffany. It would be more than a marriage. It would be a merger. You should be as happy as two IBM machines clicking away together.
So, you're not coming back to me?
That's right. A, I don't want to. B, I don't want to. C, I don't want to.
What don't you want to do?
Hello, Oscar.
I got your message. I'm shocked to see you looking so well.
What are you talking about?
Well, the answering service said it was absolutely urgent that I get over here this morning. Urgent was underlined three times.
Oh.
I presumed you were at death's door waiting for me to drop your will.
Well, no. Actually, it was something minor.
Go ahead and tell him why you asked him to come here. He was afraid he'd come home this morning and find nobody here but me. He'd have to be alone with me. Think of it, you're too late. The damage is done.
Oh, that's right. Listen to her. She knows my mind so much better than I do.
Oscar, when you go back over his account, I want you to deduct the amount he paid me in alimony. I don't want it. I never wanted it. I'm working and I don't need it.
Oh, don't be noble. There's no necessity.
Oh, but there is. Oscar, do you realize that if this poor soul had to go on paying alimony to me, he could never divorce Tiffany? Oscar, I sat at home for 9 long months and waited for him to call. Well, I'm not waiting home any longer. I'm going to pack.
Congratulations, you seem to have solved everything.
Oh, Oscar, you have no idea what you're talking about. Even my problems have problems.
What am I gonna do, Oscar? I can't marry Tiffany. She pushes in the bottles of chocolates.
I never thought you'd marry Tiffany.
Oh, stop sounding like an owl. Tell me what to do.
Get married back?
That's the conclusion I came to, but how?
Ask her.
Ask her? Last night I pleaded with her. Today I tried to be reasonable.
So that's what she's so mad about.
And can you explain to me why that should upset a woman?
Not in the time we have at our disposal. But I can tell you, you'd be better off giving her one idiotic reason.
What do you mean by that?
Tell her you want her back so you can bite her shoulder.
You try talking to her. Do you know that she actually thinks that I never thought she was pretty? Hell, I've got two wives. What did she think? I just arrived from Boston. Girl, I always thought she was pretty. First time I saw her, I thought she looked like a lovely piece of white porcelain.
Did you tell her?
Are you crazy? She would have said, porcelain? You mean like the kitchen sink?
Come now, you exaggerate.
Exaggerate nothing. You know, she actually thinks that I made a cast iron. Like I never felt a pang, but that was some sort of vegetable. You know why I put that damn telephone in the bedroom? Because I thought she might try and call me late at night some night after we broke up, and I wouldn't be able to hear the phone. Before she leaves here today, she's gonna have to hear about that phone. She's not gonna call me a block of wood. She's gonna have to face a few simple truths.
Darling, how are you feeling now? Hello, Mr. Nelson. Are you all right? I don't know what this is, but he said it would help.
Thanks, honey. It was sweet of you to dash out with things.
Bob, you have something to tell me. You've had something to tell me ever since you came in this morning.
I do? No, no. I didn't. What?
You think you're inscrutable. You're the most scrutable man I've ever met. Now tell me, sleepy or no, you know if you repress things, you eventually become devious. Now tell me.
Oscar's gonna think that you've taken an overdose of something.
Oh, don't worry about Oscar. He hasn't been surprised by anything since Truman was elected president. Now tell me.
Hey, honey, please.
All right, I'll tell you. You've discovered you're still in love with Mary.
Did I say anything whatsoever to make you think a thing like that?
Of course not, and you never would. You'd be much too embarrassed and think it was in rather bad taste. Instead, you were going to tell me all the reasons why it'd be a mistake for me to marry you. I figured it all out while I was going to the drugstore.
Oh, no, not today.
What are the reasons? I'm interested. You can bother.
Well, for one thing, he's 13 years older than I am. And that may not seem important now, but in 10 years, the gap will seem even wider. Then, two, he's a divorced man, which makes him a bad risk to start with. Really, a girl of my age deserves better than that. And finally, he's not a rich man, never will be a rich man, and could never provide the Dior originals and sable stoles that a girl of my upbringing would naturally expect.
Nonsense! I never would have brought up that part about the money. It never would have occurred to me.
But the rest of it did occur to you.
Oh, Lord. I don't mind being a bastard. What hurts is I seem to be such an inept bastard.
Tiffany. Not the buns.
Congratulations.
I thought only horses could sleep standing up.
Bob is exceptional. We shall not see his life again. What is the matter with you?
Oh my God, I should have had a sign printed up. I took three sleeping pills by accident.
Freud says there are no accidents. I think he wanted to pass out.
Maybe he was anticipating the popular demand. Dirk, that if I told you I was going with you to New Orleans, you'd go right into shock.
What do you want to bet? Mary, are you coming?
Well, I have half a mind to. I used to be superior to this sort of thing, but any minute now I'll be too old.
Yeah, that's right. You'll be 70 and you'll have nothing to repent.
May I come too? She may need a lawyer.
Oh, you wouldn't go and leave Bob like that.
Oh, I could cover him with a sheet.
Oh, how could he be so unfeeling?
My dear, he has you. When he wakes up, he has all those dried Africa.
But he doesn't have any, not anymore. We had an intelligent talk and I'm leaving. That's my boy.
I wish he could hear this. I suggest you toss a coin. The loser takes Bob.
What? Oh my God, something important is going on. I gotta stay away.
Honey, you know that this plane is being met by a gaggle of city officials. That means you have to decide right now. We have to leave in 10 minutes.
I feel like
that. You understand? Once you get on the plane, you can't change your mind and get off at 125th Street. Oh, I think we should thrash this out.
Oh, yes, that's what I think.
For sure. Why don't we just call in David Susskind and have a panel discussion? Oscar, I don't mean to be short with you. If I want to go with Dirk, why shouldn't I?
Well, for one thing, when a conservative person like you decides to embark on an indiscretion, you have to practice up on the little things before you fly off with a movie actor. You don't start at the top.
See what she means? The hierarchy.
Just a minute. What makes you all so certain that I'm just a movie star on the make and that Mary is another pickup?
Well, for one thing, you don't use her real name, and here her very own husband comes back.
But he is no longer my very own husband.
May I take this back? Remember, Mary, you and Bob chose each other. Now, you would tell me that you chose Bob in spite of his faults. I would tell you you chose Bob because of his faults. What is missing in Bob is necessary for what is missing in you. And it's not to the marriage of true impediments, admit mine.
Am I hearing right? Are you suggesting that these two stay married for mutual therapy? I haven't heard anything so dumb since my agent told me he was getting married because it made it easier to register at the Plaza.
Well, under what circumstances are you in favor of marriage?
What do you mean, in favor? Marriage is not something that has to be supported like low-cost housing or the Bill of Rights. It's something that just happens, like a sneeze, like lightning. Mary, I'll ask you once more. Will you take a chance? Will you come?
Why should he take a chance? You still yearn after Bob. I know you do.
Are we going to be naive about this? Asking me whether I yearn after Bob is much better than asking a reformed alcoholic whether he ever thinks about bourbon. What's the difference? I'm on the wagon for good and sufficient reasons, and I feel a lot better. Dirk? I am going with you.
What? Where's it going? Where are you going?
She is going to New Orleans with me.
Nonsense! I won't let her go as far as a mailbox with you.
Look, Van Winkle, you have nothing whatsoever to say.
I do still have something to say. And I
like this color. I didn't like it yesterday. Come on, Mary, let's leave winking, blinking, and nod.
What are these really?
Where? Wait a minute. I remember now. All right. Mary. Stop, Mary. Mary!
Look, I don't know if you can hear me, Bob, but goodbye.
You are one of the chief reasons as to why I am so confused. Don't you ever kiss my wife.
Bob, you're making a fool of yourself.
Shut up. You stay away from her, do you hear me? She's too good for a lounge lizard like you. She's got more goodness in her whole body than you have in your own little finger.
Dirk, let's go.
We're sold out with
nobody
today. I do so. I'm talking about you, you little idiot. And you're not going anywhere with anybody.
What the fuck?
Are you out of here?
I haven't slept in 9 months and I'm sick of it.
Hand me that key. You're in good condition. I can take it from you.
That is an absolutely true statement.
What did you do that for?
I was gonna swallow it, but a lick of it thin.
Mary, can you hear me? That lunatic has just thrown the key out into the snow. What are we going to do?
Well, the snow will melt in a day or two.
Well, in the movies, they just break down the door.
In the movies, the door is pieced together by the prop men, so all you have to do is blow on it.
Dirk, are you still there?
Sure, I'm still here.
Well, you should be. Go, this minute.
No. You will let them be furious. I'll call them up. Oh, Lord, I can't even get them now. If I don't show up, all the columns will say that I was drunk or being held somewhere on a morals charge.
Dirk!
I am going, honey. I don't know what else to do. I'll call you tonight and we'll set something up. I depend on you as the only sane member of this group to get her out of there.
Oh, so long now. It's been great seeing you again.
Goodbye.
Oh, where's my damn book?
What are you talking about, your damn book? This is my book. You gave it to me.
You said it stank.
No, I didn't. I said it wasn't punctuated. I'm punctuated.
Keep it or I'll throw it out of your school.
And I left Hollywood and came to New York because I wanted to be among intelligent people. You know, I made 3 pictures for Cecil B. DeMille, and he once said to me, if you want to get hold of a woman, don't talk to her. Get hold of her, pick her up, and carry her away. I thought to myself, this man is a jerk. Cecil, forgive me.
Mary. Mary. No, I suppose she's too angry to talk.
Why don't you try calling a locksmith? Just start with the A's.
Well, I'd stay if there was any more I could do.
Oh, Tiffany, yeah.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Tiffany, you really are a very sweet girl.
Yes, I am. Goodbye, Mr. Nelson.
Goodbye, my dear. If you're ever looking for a job, I have a large law office and can always use a young woman like you.
Oh, thank you.
You're not too upset, are you?
Oh, I'll be upset tomorrow after the Novocaine wears off. But I think tomorrow I'll feel it's just as well.
Why?
Well, I was attracted to Bob in the first place because he wasn't attracted to me. That intrigued me. Well, I don't want to sound conceited, but when you're 21, sort of pretty and very rich, you get used to men falling in love with you. But now, I ask myself, is it enough that a man is not attracted to you? Bye.
Bye.
Yeah, yes, hello. Is this a locksmith? Yeah, I have a woman locked in here.
Of course I know the woman.
Could you come right over? I know it's Sunday. I'll pay extra. Yes. 91 East 71st Street. Thank you. You'll be right over.
Good, then I may safely take my departure.
Oh, Oscar!
must act alone.
But you think she'll take the next plane after him?
Well, there are other rooms, other keys.
You're a big help.
All my clients tell me that. I'll go tomorrow.
Mary? Come on, Mary, please answer me. The locksmith's on his way. How did you get in there?
My key.
You mean you could have?
Yes, I could have.
Oh, Mary. Oh, I behaved like a slob, I know it.
Like a slob?
I made a spectacle of myself.
You certainly did. It was the silliest thing I've ever seen. You know what? I was so proud.
Oh, Mary. My beautiful darling. I always thought you were beautiful. The first time I saw you, I thought you looked like a beautiful piece of white porcelain.
White porcelain? You mean... That is so sweet. I missed your shoulder more than anything.
Oh, Mary. 100 times I would have crawled on my hands and knees to Philadelphia, but I was afraid. Mary, I'm home.
Oh, I'm home.
Oh, Mary, what am I going to do?
Well, what's the matter?
I'm falling asleep again.
Oh, that's all right.
But how are we going to get those colored lights going?
We'll manage.
Oh.